I will introduce our first panelist, Dr. Robert Carroll. Robert Carroll is a family psychiatrist and poet. He's on the clinical faculty at UCLA. He has served as vice president of the National Association for Poetry Therapy and program chair of the Southern California region. He has paired poets with brain cancer patients in UCLA's Department of Neuro-Oncology to have the poets help the patients find the words to express their experience. Dr. Carroll has published an article entitled Finding the Words to Say It, The Healing Power of Poetry, in the journal that was published in the journal Evidence-Based Complementary and Alternative Medicine. And this handout is in your electronic, among your electronic handouts as well. So please join me in welcoming Robert Carroll.
Thank you, Ping. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah, good, okay. Poetry therapy is defined as the use of poetry, journal writing, and story in the service of healing, growth, and transformation. And what I'd like to do to start is to ask all of you, how many of you have ever been moved to write a poem? So lots of you. So anybody who raised their hand, what were the circumstances under which you wrote a poem?
Stress.
Yes. And what was the experience of writing the poem?
Stress relief.
Stress relief. So you actually remember writing it and something happened that relieved you.
Well, mainly you get into that creative flow.
Yeah. So you get into a creative flow and immersion, and the stress kind of melts away. Mm-hmm. Somebody else who had their hand up. Yes?
I used to write a lot as part of or after doing meditation before.
Yes.
Body, mind,
Uh-huh. And what was your experience of doing that? Yes.
Expanded possibilities and made it really easy to tap into emotional things and also these kind of universal ideas.
So it helped her tap into universals. It helped her made her feel more connected. How about somebody on this side? Yeah. You were taken with
the
sound.
The birds and the insects.
Yes.
A unique place. It just sounded unique, and I was inspired, and I started writing.
You just started writing. And what did the experience of the writing do for you?
It caused me to just be really in the moment and enjoy enjoy it even more.
Yeah.
And really, I don't know, I felt a lot of gratitude.
Yeah.
It was beautiful.
Did any of you who raised your hands ever experience having emotional emotions churning inside you and trying to find the words to express them? You're shaking your head? Yeah? What happened? Did you write at that point?
Yeah, sometimes just
use the microphone.
That you have these things and it gives you words to put them out because it's hard.
The words come out.
Yeah.
So if you can find the words to say it, then it relieves you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, poetry is written in all cultures across the world. And it's written for the kinds of reasons that you all are giving. And if I went around, people would say, well, it helped me express a deeply emotional experience and I felt relief. They would say I felt very tight and somehow by writing the words and finding the words, it loosened things up for me. All of these things are therapeutic experiences and they all go hand in hand with what we view therapy as being, which is going towards growth, healing and transformation. So it's sort of a natural thing to see writing, expressive writing in general, the writing of poetry in particular, as having real potential for healing. And the way that I got into it myself was I had never really written any poems except until I was in my mid-40s. And I don't know why. I think I wrote one when my girlfriend left me when I was 16, and I wrote one when my dog died, and that was about it. But then I had the experience of my father's terminal decline and death, my best friend's illness and death from brain cancer. One of my patients died over the last year of my treating her, and I had a skiing accident and had to have reconstructive knee surgery. And I was feeling pretty overwhelmed. Mostly when therapists have that kind of a situation, they go to therapy. But I didn't want to do that. Been there, done that, it was enough. So I decided that maybe if I could find the words, which was what therapy would do for me, but if I could do it in the form of writing, maybe it would be helpful. And so I found a teacher. The first writing teacher I found was Dina Metzger. Do anybody know Dina? In Los Angeles, a lot of people know Dina, and she's both a healer and a poet, writer and teacher. And so I worked with Dina for about a year and a half, getting myself able to start writing. Then I found another a poet in this case named Jack Grapes. Anybody know Jack? Yeah, you know Jack. Well, it's amazing in a room this size for people not to know Jack. He's trained thousands of poets in the Los Angeles area. And for the last 21 years, I've been writing poetry. And poetry and stories and a novel and all kinds of stuff. But the thrust of what I was writing in the beginning was about the experiences that I detailed to you. The death of my father, my own mortality with having had the reconstructive injury, the terminal illness and death in my friend, and so forth and so on. So I thought, just to give you an idea of what I was writing at that time, I would read one of the poems. So this is called What Waiting Is. I found that during my father's terminal decline, I did a lot of waiting. We sit on the bench in the hospital corridor next to the cafeteria and we wait. You know what waiting is. If you know anything, you know what waiting is. It's not about you. This is about illness and hospitals and life and death. It's about the smell of the disinfectant that hits you in the head. In the bathroom, you look in the mirror. What do you see? Your father's sad face, your mother's eyes. You catch the water cupped in your thickened hands. Hope against hope, you can wash it away. The aging brown spots, the bags, the swelling truth of waiting. You go back to that bench, and maybe your mother is there with your wife who's waiting for your father, who's waiting for the news from the surgeon, or the nurse who cleans bedpans who's waiting for her shift to change, while some other man's hand clamps white as a claw to a clutch of bed sheets, and he waits. Then you hear the news and you take the long trip back to LA or Detroit, wherever you're from, and you see the faces of the drivers approach you out of the fog. And you see this one, a woman hunched over the wheel like your mother. And you think, it is my mother. And you want to tell her everything, how waiting kills and what it does to your life, how 50 years of marriage is an eyelash blink, but she's past you, headed in the other direction. So you wait. Then, out of the corner of your eye, you see your father's face in the driver's seat of a 49 powder blue Pontiac sedan, the thin sliver of his moonlit profiles smiling. But the nose is all wrong, and it's not really him, and besides, he'd never understand anyway. The impatience, the anger, the rage, the love, the fog on the windshield, never knowing if it's inside or out, because his whole life was waiting. And what does a fish know of the water, or a bird of the air? So you push the leaden accelerator down, act like you're headed to some small emergency. You don't give a damn about the cop who's waiting behind the billboard, death's over your left shoulder. You think you might want to pray, and you do pray, but you don't know what for, and anyway, you're driving. So you go back to the endless lines and lights and exit signs until you see the exit, you get home and see your light blink in your answering machine, but you don't pick it up. Instead, you go to the bathroom, take a shower, take a piss, pull out a carton of leftover food, anything, but it's cold and you can't swallow it. So you push the button and it's your sister's voice, but it's choked and she can't speak. That's how I learned the waiting was over, that my life had changed forever. This end was a beginning. I didn't know for what. I used to think it was death I was waiting for, and maybe I still am, but that's not what this is. This is life. So you show up, you do the work, you love who you love, and you learn to wait. And if you're lucky, you learn what waiting is and what you have to give. Thank you. So I was reading the, you know, I would go to workshops and I would read these poems that I wrote about my father and my friend and my dog and all of this. And people would say things to me like, they say, oh man, that poem you read about your dad, let me tell you what happened when my dad died. Or let me tell you what happened when I learned my mother had breast cancer. Or let me tell you about, and they would read their poems. And so we were in a dialogue of poetry, and we were in a community of poetry. And poetry can be healing at all different levels. It can be healing at the level of an individual. I found my voice in my writing, and it was healing for me. It can happen between people, and it can happen in community. So when I would be reading these poems, a woman came up to me from the church in Ocean Park, which is a Methodist church, and they had lost their pastor not long ago. And they came up to me, they knew about my writing poetry on illness, death, and dying, and that I was a psychiatrist. And so they asked me if I would come to their church and read some of my poetry because their pastor had died and there were other deaths in the congregation and people were having difficulty talking about it. So I did. I went and I read What Waiting Is along with a bunch of other poems, and then we all sat around in a circle together and each one of the parishioners one by one told their stories. And unfortunately we only have a half hour today, but if you look at the article that I wrote, that's in the article, including the poem that I extracted from the testimony of all of the people. It's difficult for people to talk about illness, death, and dying, but once you get them started, it's hard to stop. Another way that I've used poetry in community is, Ping mentioned to you a project I was engaged in here at UCLA in the Department of Neuro-Oncology. The department wanted me to pair poets, because I knew a lot of poets and writers in the community, with brain cancer patients. And the notion was that that if I could have my poet colleagues help the patients find the words to express their experience, and then my colleagues would write them in the form of poetry, then that might be a useful exercise in the healing process of the brain cancer patients. But then we would read those poems in a fundraiser at Royce Hall for the community of the UCLA community, the neuro-oncology community. And the poets read the poems. The patients were on stage with us. And there are a few illnesses that are as stigmatizing as brain cancer. I mean, nobody wants to hear about it. You know, they might say, oh, how are you doing? They say, well, I have brain cancer. Oh, you know, I don't need to hear about that. Nobody wants to hear about the last MRI, and certainly not the last 15 MRIs. So the opportunity was given to us via the use of poetry as a way of hearing the voices of those patients who had become stigmatized by virtue of their illness. There, but for the grace of God, go I. We raised a whole lot of money for brain cancer research, and I wanted to read you one of the poems that came out of that project. This was actually a piece that was, it was a story that was told to me by Dr. Tim Clousey, in the Department of Neuro-Oncology, which I summarized and wrote up as a poem. And the title of the poem is Amazing Change. We can go through amazing changes when we are faced with knowing we have limited time. After one woman got brain cancer, she decided what she wanted was to go to Africa to see the gorillas. She and her husband and the guides began the long trek through the jungle up the mountains. But the woman was having trouble. The guides tried to convince her to go back, but she wouldn't. She struggled and struggled. Eventually, she won the guides over, and everyone was rooting for her. But there came a point she couldn't go on. So she laid down on the grass. And when she did, the gorillas came out of the jungle to her. So is there a line in there that speaks to you, one line or two or anybody? Oh, come on. The gorillas came out of the jungle to her. Yeah. There's something transformative about that experience. I know it always, my breath always catches when I read that line and when I envision that scene. I always see myself as behind the gorilla looking over his shoulder, coming out of the jungle to her. How about somebody else? Are there any other lines in there? Yeah. She laid down in the grass. And what does that mean to you?
She was able to let go, and that's when the
let it go, yeah. And a lot of people find that when they're in the midst of their greatest struggles and they've given it their best efforts, when they finally yield, they get what they're looking for. But you have to give it your all, and she did. Anybody else? Any other lines in the poem that spoke to people? Yeah. Yes, we have. We can go through amazing changes when we learn we have limited time. Yeah, there is something about that that sets the stage for making you think, well, I wonder how it would be for me if I learned that I had limited time. Yeah, anybody else? Those are typically the three. Yeah.
Eventually, she won the guides over. Ah. Everyone was rooting for her. There came a point she couldn't go on.
Yeah. This idea that spoke to you. You know, if you're around poetry, one of the things that people will talk about is how does a poem work? What does it do? How does the structure of a poem work? And here in just this very short little poem, there are four different lines that speak to people. The poem doesn't speak to everybody in the same way. Some people may read this poem and say, well, you know, it doesn't get to me at all. But for the four of you, there was something in each of those lines that spoke to you. And that actually can become a resource to you because it could become a tool whereby you discover something about yourself by doing some writing of your own. So what I would like you to do is I would like to take 5 minutes I want each of you to think about a time when you had limited time, or a time when you were waiting, or a time that any of the other lines in the poetry that I've read to you spoke to you, and just write for 5 minutes about that time. Then we'll have a few of you come up and read. Thank you. So just take one more minute and finish up whatever you're writing. You guys are really into it. That's nice. Everybody's busily. That's good. So, who would like to read what you've written? Anybody? Okay, microphone. Please.
I know Tom is not on her side. cancer is literally eating every inch of her body. But she was not willing to accept that.
I think the volume is off.
It was so painful to be there for her because I know death was inevitable. It's been 3 weeks now since Gail departed. At her funeral, her sister gave me a letter that she wrote for me. I still have not opened the letter 3 weeks later. I need time to mourn her death.
Thank you. Did you hear those lines? There has been 3 weeks since Gail departed. How close that is. You know, when we write, and particularly when we write as this woman is writing about something that's so deeply moving to us, it's important that we have what's called an aesthetic distance. An aesthetic distance means that you have 1 foot in the circumstances, and so you're experiencing it, and 1 foot out so that you can write about it. So that's called the aesthetic distance. And the words that you wrote, what's your name?
Victoria.
The words that Victoria wrote are the key to just a huge amount that could be written. And maybe you'll take it as an opportunity to continue the writing process. And by doing that, your relationship to the events will change, and you'll see it. Somebody else? Could you give her? Oh, do you have it? You go ahead, and then you can go next.
Is it today? Is it today, the day after the years of shuffling, the day after she took out the recycling, the day after the fall? Is it today? Can we have a fight now and get it over with? My brother says, let's play cards, that will work. But all we did was laugh together. Is it today? I'll get the stretcher and the recliner so we can all sleep here together with her. Mm. Is it today? We'll bring in the Shabbos and sing around her bed, a woman of valor. Is it today? Dad, did you tell her it was okay for her to go? Mm. Is it today? We all slept and breathed together as she took her last breath.
Mm. You all hear that? Lovely. You know, I just want to comment on the rhetorical quality of the piece, which was obviously very deeply held and deeply felt. But the device of repeating the line, is it today, is it today, is it today, is it today, is a mesmerizing kind of technique. It's a rhetorical style. It's Martin Luther King. It's Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. It's the repetition of lines to set up a rhythm, to develop an expectation, both for the writer who's in that rhythm, and for the listener who's hearing it. And then if you didn't use it, people want to know where that line is because it's become such a strong underpinning of the piece. But that was very lovely. And over there.
As a child, I didn't understand. He and I had played together the day before. Why was he in the hospital? Why was my mother crying? I won't cry. He was never the same. He died that night. He had a stroke. He died 4 years later. I won't cry.
Very nice. You know, like I say, it's difficult to talk about illness, death, and dying because people, they just don't want to talk about it, and other people don't want to hear it. But once you find ways through poetry and through finding, you know, kind of giving the permission and giving the space to be able to talk about it, it's hard to get people to stop. And I reckon if we had another half hour, there would be another 10 or 20 of you that would add your voices to the chorus. But for right now, we're out of time, so I'm going to turn it back over to Ping. Thank you.